From 8.
The Radio Wammo Breakfast.
Issues of the day under T-Radar.
Issues indeed. Later on in the week than usual, but and of course earlier as well. But T-Radar's with us. Morning, T-Radar.
Yes, very good.
Mm. Yeah, you haven't seen the movie about the invasion of the giant ants, have you?
No, I haven't. But I just generally get worried about invasions from normal-sized ants.
Yeah, this is true. I've had a bit of that this year.
Oh, what did you use to get rid of them?
Well, we ended up getting some kind of jelly.
No.
Toxic jelly.
Yes, and they take it back to the nest. And,
yeah.
And chaos. And
feed it to the young.
Yes, there's so many of them, ants, and they're so busy all the time.
Aren't they just?
Yes, never have a day off.
With the business that they get up to.
Yes, they're ant-based business. Yes, always doing something.
Yeah, would you poison them? That's kind of what we've done. We've only done it to one ant colony.
Mm.
We haven't unleashed the fury, the pain onto the rest of them yet.
No, generally if they're out and about, I leave them alone. When they come to the house, you start to think, oh, get out of my honey.
Yeah.
Stop going into the marmalade.
It wasn't yours, you didn't purchase it.
Yes, but you know, they're only doing as nature intended.
Yes.
But enormous colonies sometimes. I think there was one the other day somewhere I saw it. The size of a city block. Enormous. They sort of excavated it out. Oh, no, I think, oh, did they put plaster casts in it? I think they pumped it full of plaster.
And so that'd be like one of those ones that, in a jungle somewhere.
Yes, it was, yes. And then they dug it out and just phenomenal. I guess that's what happens, you know. There's a good moral in there somewhere. One tiny person can, you know, beavering away with other people can create an enormous thing.
Well, one of my favourite episodes of MacGyver was the ant episode. You remember that when he was in a compound in the middle of the jungle, and all these fire ants were descending on the compound, and they had to try and keep the fire ants at bay, and they were using, you know, like flamethrowers and stuff. But eventually, they blew up a dam, and the water washed them away.
Look, to be honest, I don't recall that.
Oh, okay.
No,
moving right along.
No, I don't. Look, time for a change for the flag, apparently.
Again.
Look, how often? Is this, what, twice a year now?
Yeah.
Three times a year that this happens?
Yeah. Apparently, now it's the Herald's crusade to change the flag.
Oh, gosh. You're always a bit worried when newspapers go on a crusade.
Mm.
But apparently, according to the front page of the Herald website, patriots agree. So, therefore, it is time.
Who are these patriots?
I don't know, but they're living patriots, apparently.
Oh, okay.
Let me have a look.
That's always important.
Yes, and there's several different sorts of flags that people have proposed there. So
it would be a bit of a worry if they said more dead patriots agree that the flag be changed.
Yes, you know, and then, of course, you've got I was listening to a bit of talk back on the way home from somewhere last night, and some guy rang him. He said, look, I knew men who fought in the war, and they fought and died for that flag. And you do wonder, look, was it really for the flag, or was that just a symbol, or, you know, was it a greater sort of thing? And then at the end of the day, you think, well, there are a lot of people who did do that, and it's only going to be a few more years before, regrettably, most of them will be dead. And, you know, perhaps we just wait. Do we just wait a little while so that we don't upset their sensibilities? Because, you know, they did put in a sterling job.
Mm.
But
in saying that, I mean, what are we hoping for at the end of the process? Once we get a new flag, I mean, are we hoping to reach some kind of higher plane of consciousness?
Look,
are we going to be happy?
Yes, is it just going to be this wonderful panacea that will cause us all to, you know, stop doing the things that makes our nation slightly reprehensible? No, I don't imagine it will.
What are we looking for in it?
I know what I'm not looking for. I'm not looking for a silver fern on a black background, because that appears to me not to be a flag so much as a piece of branding.
Yes.
Some form of advertising that you stick on a product that you wish to flog off to people.
Yes.
Something about a flag.
Talking about that,
well,
this might be a little bit of an awkward one, T-Radar, but we're going to go there.
All right.
The chap who wanted, or they found out in his will afterwards, that he wanted his tattoos removed.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but I looked at the tattoos and I thought, I don't know, probably not worth preserving.
Oh, look, I'm sure that they were for the family.
One of them was an export gold.
Well, he was the country's largest collector of export gold.
Oh, for goodness sake. It's one of the, you know, like, it's not exactly one of the best beer brands that exists in the country, and it's owned by a corporate.
Yes, but I guess each to their own. And in a time of grief, you know, he did will his tattoos to be saved. And unfortunately, the those orders weren't carried out before he was, before he was burned. What's it called?
Cremated.
Yes. Exactly. You know, and it's lots of interesting things. I was thinking about it the other day. I suddenly thought I wanted to have a Viking funeral. I wanted to get a little dinghy and fill it full of wood and push it out into the lake and be burnt. But then I thought, well, that's never going to happen. You know, there'll be issues, there'll be resource consent, there'll be Maori rights, there'll be just the general fact that you're not allowed to put your body in a dinghy and burn it.
There'll be regulations around
it. Yes. But, you know, I feel sorry for the family. They did want to keep these, you know, and regardless of what we think of the rights or wrongs of tattoos, because I tell you what, there's a lot of young people out there these days with some quite scary tattoos. Big Day Out, great example of people, and you look at them and you think, oh dear, what are you, in a few years' time, you're going to look at that and think, that was not the wisest move.
Yes.
Particularly young, there's one young woman with quite an intricate sort of old school tattoo on her back, the whole back covered with it. And I thought, oh, that looks good while your flesh is young and taut, but in a few years, you're just going to have a sort of an oddly green back.
But besides all the argument about whether or not his wishes were followed, but apparently that's never been done in New Zealand before, removed
really?
A tattoo.
A little bit of skin preservation.
It's just not done.
No, I wonder who would have got to do it. Because, you know, you take it off and you dry it and it becomes a little bit like a piece of parchment. But and you put it, I guess, in your photo album.
There's also many other things in life that you might wish that you could happen to you afterwards, but you just don't do it.
Yes, I want to
be
sort of taxidermied and sat in the corner.
Well, that's right, we won't do it.
No.
It's gruesome.
Yeah, it is a bit gruesome. Yes, no, mostly you're sort of just in a box and in a hole or set on fire.
Hey, let's look at...
I hope you're going to say Bear Grylls.
But what?
Bear Grylls. I hope you're going to say Bear Grylls.
No, it wasn't. But do tell. What?
Oh, look, apparently 7,000 people have joined an online campaign to bring Bear Grylls to New Zealand. Bear Grylls, for those who don't know, man versus wild.
That's right.
He goes out and he saves himself in the wild, and they want to bring him to Fiordland.
He's a lunatic.
He is a lunatic. I saw him the other day. Best one yet. He was trying to survive on a tiny little raft in the middle of the ocean.
Why?
I don't know. Because I do know. Obviously, this is something that does happen to a number of people. And if it should happen to you, and you've watched Bear Grylls' program, you may just survive.
But, you know, we know the whole thing about this whole reality show about him surviving. You know, he's got his cameraman there. There's also the sound guy. There's the producer. There's an army of
yes, apparently there was controversy. He would fly back to a hotel and stay for a few nights, all that kind of thing. But then again, at the same time, he does actually do a lot of the stuff. He does cut the heads off snakes and drink their blood.
He likes getting his todger out.
He does. He drank water from a camel carcass, amongst other things. So, you know, it was a wonderful piece to camera he did at the beginning of a show where he was chatting, and then he was in a helicopter, and he sort of sat back, got onto the blades, dropped back, and hung off his feet, and then let go and plummeted to the earth without missing a beat. Now, that is a guy who has got a certain degree of skill.
Yeah, he fancies himself as a real-life Bond.
He does, and to be fair, he sort of is.
He kind of is.
And, you know, I wouldn't begrudge a real-life Bond a few nights in a hotel when he's out there surviving in the bush.
There are some fantastic spoofs on this as well.
I'm sure there are.
On the net, you should look some of those up.
Yes.
Done very, very well.
Yes. Now, what were you going to mention before, Bear
I was
Grylls?
Going to mention this silly business about the Rugby World Cup.
Yes.
I'm seriously considering not being in the country when it's here.
What, you know what, rent out your bed sit?
Yeah, I think that might be a smart bed sit.
There you go, bunk bed for two.
That might be a smart thing. I'm just over this obsession with the game here in New Zealand and the fact that it's going to completely, even if you don't want it to, even if you're not even going to watch it, it'll somehow affect your life in the next year, and particularly if you're at school.
Yes, well, some schools are going to have to disrupt their exam preparations, apparently, because the first week of 2011, 2 weeks longer than the last term, so that it makes the last term 2 weeks shorter. Everything's going to be a bit jiggery-pokery to accommodate all of the games and the transport and the chaos from this poison chalice that is the World Cup.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, so it's, you know, at the end, perhaps, you know, we just get into it and go, hooray, here it is, and we can all, I don't know, get out on the... we could get out on the street and sell memorabilia, but you can't do that. You'll have to have a permit. Probably can't sell water to people in queues.
No.
It's all so regulated and so much furore.
We might even have a new flag by then.
We may even have a new flag by then, but some of us will no doubt do well. We'll be selling out our bed sits. We'll be hiring in, you know, people to help cater to, you know, foreign people that are staying in our house, and it's all, there's money to be made by everyone, I expect, apart from the poor old ratepayer and the taxpayer.
On that note, that positive note, T-Rader.
Maybe next week we can think of something we can do to make the World Cup more pleasant.
All right. In the meantime, let's think about it. See ya.
All right.